mistakes and we've fallen short. So, Lord, we ask for your forgiveness. We confess those sins to you right now. Lord, we thank you for hearing us. And we thank you for keeping those things that tempt us far away from us. So help us to live a life worthy of the calling that you've given us. And as we open up your word in just a moment, we need your help there. We need your spirit to open up our eyes, our ears, and our hearts to be receptive to this idea of how we can build through joyous giving. Lord, we want you to understand that we give our lives to you because you first gave your life for us. So lead us and guide us as we continue this service, as we make some commitments. But now, Lord, as we open up your word, realize this story of life that you've given us was meant to be lived for you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, now's the time for the kids to come forward. Now, I know in the rows like this, it may be difficult, so please don't trip any of the children. We're going to go right in front of that board over here. So don't touch it. Don't touch it. Back up just a little bit. Judah and Asher and Benjamin, if you could back up just a little bit so we have room for our volunteers. Back up. Good job. Come on in. All kids are welcome. Kids of all ages are invited to come up. So come on this way. There's some more room over here. Good to see you. Come on up. All right. Good job. Come on in and have a seat. Hi, how are you? It is so good to have you here with us today as we finish up our Building for the Journey series. And today we're talking about building through joyful giving. And what we're going to see is that the very first church that ever existed in Jerusalem was going through some difficult times. And in order to encourage them, Paul and the other churches around the world collected a wonderful offering to give to those people who are in need. And what we see in today's text is that the churches in this place called Macedonia gave of themselves to the Lord. And what we're going to see is that that allowed them to give their whole life to the Lord. And so I thought of, how can I illustrate that to you? I thought of the classic game of life. We say, kids, have you ever played the game of life before? Adults, have you ever played the game of life before? Very good. And so if you take a look at this particular game of life, next slide please, Kelly. The next slide shows us that there's already a game going on. Someone has already started this game, and so we don't have time to finish the game, but since it's already started, now back up a little bit. Be honest with me. Can I have three volunteers that have not been called on in 2017? That have not been called on in 2017? You're all thinking, ooh, wait. I think I was. Ben Miller, I know you were. I think you're vivid. All right. Okay, one, come on up. Yeah, come here. Let's go. Jackson, I called on you this year already, right? Anybody else? Okay, two. I know I called on you too. Taylor, I know I called on you too. I'm trying to share the love. All right, come on. I called on him too, but that's okay. He's little, he forgot. Okay. All right, so we need over here, let's have one. Okay. You're going to be player one, so come over here. And then let's see player two. Actually, I think I'm going to have you be three, and you're going to be two, okay? All right, so here we go. So take a look at this board, okay? So you're player one, I said, right? All right, here is all the moolah you're going to start out with, okay? All right, I think I said you're player two, right? Okay, and then here is your money. Okay, so who is player one? Are you ready? So you're going to spin the dial, okay? All right, so you're the red car, so you can move seven spaces with the red car. Go ahead, go in this way. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Good job. And so right there, that's a life card. All right, I think I have it on the screen. Kelly, can we see the life card? So this is who you are. Player one, you are a successful lawyer. You have a spouse, and the Lord has allowed you to earn a boatload of money. The bank pays you $2,000 for a smart investment. Let's give her a round of applause. I'm the banker. Wow. Show everybody the stack of cash you got. Look at, ooh, okay. All right, I believe you're number two. Okay, go ahead, so you're gonna move that, all right. Yeah, it's supposed to be, yeah, that's good. Okay, go ahead. Yeah, no, you're... Yeah. Oh, you know what? All of the guys, someone must have been messing with this. So ignore the amount of people in there, okay? You spontaneously had some children. Okay, here we go. Player number two, are you ready? You are a single doctor trying to build up your own private practice in an area in desperate need of quality medical care. Everything you earn gets reinvested into your practice. A new subdivision is built next to your clinic, which provides nonstop patients, collects $5,000 for services rendered. Wow! Well done. Are you ready? Go ahead and spin. Oh, try again. Nice. Okay. So you're going to move two spaces, so you are the blue one. Very good. Are you ready? You also get a life card. Here we go. Ready? You are a garbage truck driver. You have a spouse and two children. On most weeks, you have just enough money to make ends meet. Pay the bank $1,000 for this month's mortgage payments. See, the kids are clapping. They don't know what they're clapping about. Right, I'm the bank man. Give me your money. Where's your money? All right, very good. So you get some change here. All right, we got time for one more roll, and this is an important roll. Okay, player number one, go ahead and roll. All right, move 8 spaces. It's okay. I know, isn't that crazy? All right, you get another life card. Here we go. It's up on the screen too there, Kelly. You realize that everything you have belongs to the Lord. Overwhelmed by generosity, you give a portion of your money to a charity of your choosing. So show everybody the amount of money you have. All right, how much do you want to give to the charity of your choosing? What are you thinking? Can you see the wheels turning? Wow, did you see that? Now, what's the charity of your choosing? Well, this is an awful lot of money. Maybe there's a local congregation in need of some assistance at a building project. That's like comes later. So why don't you pray about who you're going to give this to? Okay, we'll set what this service is at. Okay, player number two, go ahead and roll. All right, move one space to your yellow. Very good. You also get a life card. Here we go. It's up on the screen. Uh-oh. A terrible drought and famine hits your region. People begin to sell their homes and move away. There's a good chance your private practice may have to close. Give the bank every single dollar you have to repay your small business loan. Oh, everybody go, oh. Wait, we're not done yet. We're not done yet. Last one. Make it a good one. 8, move 8, so you're blue, move 8. Close enough, good job. Player number 3, you realize that everything you have belongs to the Lord. Knowing that Jesus Christ gave his very life to save us, you decide to give what you have on behalf of the Lord to your neighbor, the doctor, whose mission it was to reach those in need. Are you willing to do that? Oh, you know what I mean? But that's what the card says. You have to. That's what the Lord has allowed you to do. Come on now. No. On behalf of the Lord, you're supposed to give everything. All right, let's give them all a round of applause. Kids, what I wanted to try to illustrate is sometimes in life we go through difficult things. And sometimes we feel like the deck is stacked against us. But what we're going to see in today's Bible passage is that never prevented God's people from being generous with those in need. And in today's passage, we're going to see how this group of people who had very, very little were willing to give everything they had for the furthering of God's kingdom. So good job listening. Hang on. I don't want anybody to get knocked in the head like that. All right, so go ahead. I'm going to bring the candy this way. Let's give all of our volunteers a round of applause. Good job, guys. All right, so you guys can return to your seats after you grab a piece of candy. Everybody else, if you brought your Bibles with you, if you could please open up to 2 Corinthians chapter 8. We're going to be starting with verse 1. Good job, guys. Excellent. Well, again, thank you so much for being here today. We're excited that you're here. We know that it's always awkward to go into a new space. because you're maybe a little bit uncomfortable, maybe the seats just don't fit you quite right, and we know that we're here for a very specific purpose, and that is to praise God for what He has done in our midst these last 8 years. But what I wanted to try to illustrate to the kids is that this game of life, or this journey that we call life, sometimes has its twists and turns. But through it all, God's people are called to be set apart in order to have this perspective of generosity through joyful giving. And so the passage we're looking at today deals with a time in church history where God's people were going through some difficult times. Now, if you know your church history, after the resurrection of Jesus, after the ascension, and then after the day of Pentecost, God's people shared the gospel of Jesus, and thousands of people came to the faith. And so Jerusalem was really where the first church started. And as that church grew and as it ministered to the people, Christians went throughout all the known world and proclaimed the good news and planted churches. Eventually, you had people like Paul that were sent out to the non-Jewish folks, the Gentiles, to bring and plant churches all throughout the world. But over time, a terrible famine occurred in Jerusalem. And the persecution occurred not only by the religious leaders and the Jewish faith, but also the Romans. And so that first church of Jerusalem began to struggle. And so since they'd sort of been the home base, the mother church for all of the other mission emphasis, people like Paul would often make a collection for those that were in need. And so we pick up today's passage looking at the second letter that we have that Paul wrote to the church of Corinth. Last week we looked at the first letter. And what we find is that God's people are starting to get their act together. Remember last week we said the people in Corinth were sort of a hot mess. And it was just a strange situation. But again, the Lord is leading them and encouraging them, and Paul commends them in today's passage. But they are in a season of blessing. And so just like we illustrated in the game of life, sometimes we go through seasons of harvest. Sometimes we go in seasons of drought. And so the people of Corinth were going through a tremendous time of blessing. And so Paul encourages them. He doesn't command them. He encourages them to participate with some other churches so that they too can give back to the Lord for what He has done for them. So keep that in mind as we take a look at verse 1. It's going to be up on the screen. And now, brothers and sisters, we want you to know about the grace that God has given the Macedonian churches. Out of the most severe trial, their overflowing joy and their extreme poverty welled up in rich generosity. For I testify that they gave as much as they were able, and even beyond their ability, entirely on their own. They urgently pleaded with us for the privilege of sharing in the servants to the saints. They did not do as we expected, but they gave themselves first to the Lord, and then to us. And in keeping with God's will, so we urge Titus, since he had early made it the beginning, to bring also to completion this act of grace on your part. But just as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in complete earnestness in your love for us, see to it that you excel in this grace of giving. Now I am not commanding you, but I want to test the sincerity of your love by comparing it with the earnestness of others. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though He was rich, yet for your sakes He became poor, so that you, through His poverty, might become rich. And so here's my advice about what is best for you in this matter. Last year you were the first not only to give, but also to have the desire to do so. Now finish the work, so that your eager willingness to do it may be matched by your completion of it, according to your means. For if the willingness is there, the gift is acceptable, according to what one has, not according to what he does not have. So our desire is not that others might be relieved while you are hard-pressed, but that there might be equality. And at the present time, your plenty will supply what they need, so that in turn, their plenty will supply what you need. Then there will be equality. For as it is written, he who gathered much did not have too much. And he who gathered little did not have too little. So at this point in the letter, Paul is really commending the church in Corinth because they've grown in their faith. Remember, he was part of the founding of this church. He had written several letters pointing out how they sort of went off the rails. They sort of went off mission. And yet now Paul is writing again, knowing there's still a few things going on, but wanting to commend them that they had grown in the faith, that they had done some amazing things. And because of that, the Lord was just blessing them with this season of plenty. But now we understand that that's not true for all churches. Some churches were going through a very difficult time. And one of those, or at least a group of them mentioned right off the bat, is the churches in Macedonia. Can we see that map, please, Kelly? I believe that's up there. So if you look at that map, Corinth is right there in the middle. And see, north of there, we have the Macedonian churches of Berea, Thessalonica, and Philippi. Now, those churches, we know, were very poor churches. They didn't have very many resources. And in addition to that, many of the business owners that were part of those churches, because of their faith, they were losing business from the surrounding culture because there was persecution because of their faith. But even though they had very little material wealth, that they had this amazing heart of faith that they couldn't help but joyfully give to this contribution to help the saints in Jerusalem. Thank you, Kelly. And so thinking of those churches, he points out, brothers and sisters, we want you to know about this grace, and we'll talk about that in a minute, that God has given to those three churches in Macedonia out of their most severe trial. Like sometimes when we have bad days, we're thinking, oh, whew, we had a bad day. Bad day in the first century is when family members are taken away by soldiers because of the faith. And yet they held on in the midst of that persecution. But out of the midst of this trial, they had this overflowing joy. When you have a bad day, think, am I exuding joy? Normally you're like, I'm having a bad day. These folks had such a faith that even though they were going through a difficult time, their response was overflowing joy. And out of their extreme poverty, it welled up in rich generosity. Amazing. For I testify, Paul was actually there. They gave as much as they were able, even beyond their ability to do so. And so it'd be like if you have a family member that you know just lost their job. And they're saying to you, I really want to support this missionary who's going to Mexico. And you say, hey, you know, you kind of got to pay your mortgage first. You got to pay your car insurance and gas. And this church is saying, no, I'm not going to worry about all that because I want to give generously to the people in need. And so Paul points out that they actually urged him for the privilege of sharing in the service for the saints. I mean, can you imagine someone arguing with you because they have little means and want to give more, and they're saying, no, we don't want to miss this opportunity to commit to giving to this wonderful, wonderful people in need in Jerusalem. And they did not as we expected. And this is what I love about the passage. They gave themselves first to the Lord. Now, in a short while, we're going to bring our commitment cards up into this basket. And so we have to ask ourselves, what does it mean to give yourself to the Lord? Well, I think what Paul's trying to illustrate here is that the people of Corinth, they rededicated their lives to the Lord. Right? If they had a choice to make, even in the midst of some difficult times, they were jumping into the faith with both feet. They were giving not just part of their life. Sometimes we do that, right? And again, I was guilty of this when I was a teenager, and so again, forgive me, that I had the Bennett church. I had the Bennett around my parents and family, and then I had the Bennett school. Anybody ever be honest, right? Yeah, sure. What this passage is illustrating is that for the most part, this entire group of churches around Macedonia, they didn't have different people. They had their entire life thrown at the feet of the Lord. They didn't compartmentalize it. They gave every ounce of their being for service of the Lord. And they should be commended. They gave themselves first to the Lord and then to us in keeping with God's will. And so we here have mentioned that Titus, one of Paul's helpers, brought at first one collection, and now they're asking to come back. And not to flatter the church, but in verse 7, we see that Paul says, you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in complete earnestness of love for us. See to it that you also excel in this one area of ministry, the grace of giving. Now think back to Valentine's Day. How many of you had a good Valentine's Day? How many of you had a piss poor Valentine's Day? Why? Ask yourself, right? There's always this debate, is Valentine's Day just another Hallmark holiday, right? so the chocolate growers of the world would be wealthy on the backs of all our... No. But think about it here. If you and your spouse, or you and your boyfriend, or you and a friend, right, decided to go out for dinner in a movie on Valentine's Day, how would you feel if that spouse or that friend or that boyfriend or girlfriend says, "You better take me out for dinner in a movie. Oh, you better, or else..." Could you imagine if you were commanded to give someone a gift or take someone out? Would you really want to go?
No!
No! Can I get an amen? Yeah. Of course not. You want people to want to spend time with you. You want people to want to give you a gift of love. Paul is saying in this passage, he doesn't want to command them. He wants them to demonstrate the sincerity of their love by comparing it to the earnestness of others, namely the Macedonian church. And here is the most important verse for us today, verse 9. "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ." If you were here last week, we talked about it a lot, the word there for grace. The biblical concept, the Greek word in there is charis, and this is what it refers to. All of this in this one little word. The merciful kindness by which God, exerting his holy influence upon souls, turns them to Christ, keeps, strengthens, increases them in the Christian faith, knowledge, affection, and kindles them to the exercise of Christian virtues. All of that is what we have access to because of what Jesus did for us. And so Paul gives one example of the Macedonians, but now he gives the example, the ultimate example of Jesus. That though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor. Now what does Paul mean there? Does that mean, like we saw with the kids, was Jesus flush with cash? No. The riches that Paul is referring to is, remember, Jesus is and was God incarnate. And before he came on Christmas, he was up there in heaven enjoying the glorious wonders of God the Father. And the saints gathered around and worshiping him. The King of the universe gave up all of that to become like you and me. He gave up the glory and the wonder and the light of heaven and came to our cold, dirty, dusty, disease-ridden planet. So from this great riches, he became poor. And so Paul points out, what an amazing example. What an amazing testimony. So that you, meaning you and I, through his poverty, remember? The King of the universe not only became a little baby, when he grew up, he allowed himself to get spit on and beaten and executed on a cross. That's how much his poverty cost him. But because of that poverty, we might become rich. We might have access to the eternal riches of heaven, and most importantly, eternal life. And so Paul is saying, if the Macedonians can do that, if Jesus our Savior can do this, what are you going to do? How are you going to respond? And so the final passage says, look, this is my advice. What's best for you? Last year you gave some and you had a desire to do so. Give to the work until you have completion, according to your means. For if the willingness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not what according to what he doesn't have. And here's the summary Paul gives to the church. Our desire is not that others might be relieved by you being hard-pressed. He doesn't want to put people out, but there might be equality. And whenever we see that word equality in Scripture, sometimes people get confused. We're not talking that Paul wants everybody to be equal, or that he could somehow guarantee an equality of outcomes. What he is saying, that since the Jerusalem church is struggling and there's all these people in need, and in the current phase and station on the road of the game of life, the people in Corinth have quite a bit, he's asking that they would share some of what they have for those that are in need. And he says that, and at the present time, your plenty will supply what they need. So he's talking about more equality, not of results, but of opportunity, so that in turn, their plenty will supply you with what you need, and there will be equality. And the passage ends with this wonderful Old Testament allusion. I think it's Exodus 16. He who gathered much did not have too much, and he who gathered little did not have too little. Remember God speaking when they were out in the wilderness, they were hungry, and they went complaining to Moses and said, "We need food." Moses said, okay, Lord, what are you going to do? And then some manna, some bread fell from heaven. But God gave really strict instructions. If you're a family of two, or you're a single, or you have five or six, you only go out that day and collect the amount of bread that your family needs. If you only have a little bit of eat, just take little. If you have a lot of eat, take a lot. And those stinkers that took more than they were supposed to, the very next day, that amount that they had, rotted. And what Paul is trying to illustrate is that, look, we serve a big God who's not short of cash. And he's got this amazing riches. And again, keep in mind that when the Bible talks about riches, it's not always, and it's really not usually, monetary riches. That we have this kingdom understanding that the riches that come with a commitment to Christ, you cannot measure what that is worth. And so when you think back to the children's sermon there, can you see that please? We see this game of life. Just by a show of hands, how many of you like the game of life? Another show of hands, how many of you hate the game of life? Here's the reason I don't like it. And if you enjoy it, please don't be offended by this. I don't like the fact that I have absolutely no control over my life. You just sort of spin that wheel and you're like, oh no, oh no, am I going to have to pay taxes? Oh no, am I going to get a mortgage? Oh no, oh no. In life, I need you to know something. You're not in control here. I had to come to that conclusion very early in my life because I was never going to find joy in my life if I tried to control everything. Because I'm not in control. None of us are. But I know the guy who is. And he says to us that sometimes in life, we go through difficult times. I'm going to see if the microphone picks this up. And we spin and we go through this difficult time and oh no, as we saw, we may lose things. We may gain things. We go through these seasons of life. But through it all, what keeps us stable, what keeps us different from all the other people in the world that like a boat in a sea in a storm get knocked all over the place, we are anchored in the fact that we know that God is in charge. And even when we go through those difficult seasons and we feel like the deck is stacked against us, we know that our eternity is secure. We know that behind our life, something is going on that we might not be able to see. Because the other thing about the game of life is you get so consumed by your bankroll. Oh, sometimes you're so obsessed by what's going on in your life, you don't look to see what's going on in the lives of people around you. And what you need to understand and what we need to understand today is that regardless of where the journey of our life takes us, behind it all, behind everything that's going on, stands the cross. Can we see that, please, Kelly? We understand that behind our life stands the sacrifice, as we saw in the passage, becoming poor for us so that we could be rich in God's kingdom. Thank you, Kelly. And so all year long, we have been working hard to make room at the table of the Lord. And so in a few minutes after I pray, we're going to invite folks to come forward and to bring their commitment cards. Now, if you look on those commitment cards, there's an option for everybody. Okay? I don't know everybody in this room. Some I don't know at all. But I can guarantee you that there's something on that commitment card that you can't commit to. Not because I'm commanding you to do it, because we're asking you to ask the Lord what you can do for the ministry of this church. And so when we think about that, we understand that for some people, your commitment today is to give your entire life to the Lord. Maybe today is going to be the first day that you recognize that Christ has done something for you. You're going to accept Him as your personal Lord and Savior so that you can have an enjoyment of the eternal riches of God's kingdom. And for that, we're grateful. For others of you here today, maybe as you've been praying the last few weeks, that like we saw in today's passage, that giving your entire lives for you is rededicating your life to the Lord. So that you don't have your family personality, you don't have your work personality, and then over here, maybe if you could get the service, then you have your church personality. No, no, no. God wants it all because He owns it all anyway. But he requires us to make some of those decisions. And so in a few minutes, we're going to walk forward. And I want you to not so much look at this table. But again, it's important, right? Because we feel we need to make room for people. And so unlike the church in Jerusalem, right now we're not going through serious persecution. Okay? The Lord has blessed us financially. But the need is more people in this community. And you know them. They're your neighbors. They're your family members. They are overwhelmed by what life has dealt them. They don't know what to do. And yet you and I know the answer to the problem. You and I have the solution to life's biggest question. Why am I here? And we know that that is to glorify God and enjoy Him forever. Those are the riches that you and I have access to. Not because we deserve it, not because we're better than anybody else, but because of what Jesus did for us on the cross. And so when you bring that commitment card forward, I ask that you look past even this ministry opportunity. Because when you give to a ministry like this, when you give to a church, when you give to a mission field or a mission work, you're actually not giving to those individuals. You are, but you're actually giving back to the Lord. And so I invite you to look past this basket. And while it's important and the table's important, I want you to look at this cross and recognize what Christ has done for us. The least we can do is make a commitment to follow Him each and every day of our life. So I'm going to pray. And then we're going to play an instrumental. And then starting in the first rows, if you have a commitment card, we'd love to come forward. So thanks for being here tonight. Heavenly Father, we are grateful for what you have done. Lord, we cannot say it enough. Thank you for dying for us on the cross. And so, Lord, as we think about this table, as we think about making room through a potential building expansion, Lord, we know it's not about us. It's not about a building. It's about those people in this community, in this county, that do not yet know you. And yet, Lord, they are feeling emotionally poor, spiritually poor, and they need to have access to the wonderful riches of your salvation. Lord, we feel that our church is uniquely gifted to do that. And so, Lord, help us. Bless our efforts. Lord, we give it all to you, not just on Sundays, not just when it's convenient, not when it doesn't hurt. Lord, we give it all to you. And so, Lord, we thank you for bringing us to this moment where we can say thank you for what you've done for us. We pray these things in Jesus' name.
Oh, honor and praise to God for the commitments that were made. Let's just
your God's blessing as you leave this place. May the love of God the Father, the grace of our Savior Jesus Christ, and the courage of the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of you now and forevermore. And all God's people say,
Amen.
Amen. So let's sing the whole song. And I will be